Nirvana. And the answer to that question is that essentially there is Nirvana. And if you wish, I can talk about this very broadly. I can talk a bit about the history of these teachings. I can talk a bit about the development of Buddhist canon and the Buddhist ideas over the past 2,500 years. If you wish, if you want to, you can ask me questions about this. But for now, I will just say that essentially, yes, we know what these teachings are and what they are. If you're interested, is what is known as the four Nikayas. Nikaya is like a collection, yeah, four collection of discourses, and these are called the long discourses, easy, yeah, middle length discourses, yeah, short discourses, no, not the short ones, that's what you would expect, then, long, middle, no, connected discourses, and the numerical discourses of the Buddha. These four collections are essentially what we look at when we talk about the teachings of the Buddha, yeah, and then the main teachings in there. I'm going to refine this down a little bit more later on. That is essentially what it is about. So my job during this retreat, yeah, when the retreat is over, it's going to be like, you can't wait to get your hands on those books to start reading them, yeah? That is my job. I see you running off from the nearest bookshop, yeah? Kind of getting onto Amazon.com straight away, as soon as you can turn on your device, and then ordering those four Nikayas. Then I will have done my job. If you say, yeah, those suit, I'm not sure if I'm interested in that, then I will have failed miserably. Which is, if that happens, please don't tell me, because I feel really bad afterwards. Because we can just kind of sneak off after the end of the retreat instead. So that is the purpose. And what is very powerful about this, one of the things that I'm hoping to do during this retreat is to inspire you a little bit through this sutras. And what you will find is that if you find inspiration in the world of the Buddha, if that lifts you up, if that brightens your mind, if that gives you a sense of joy and happiness, yeah, if this really works properly, then it will be a powerful source to actually use for your meditation practice. It will also propel your meditation practice forward at the same time. So these things actually go together. If you understand the suttas in the right way, just the joy of hearing the suttas, or just the understanding that you get from them, helps your meditation practice. When a meditation practice goes better, you feel more calm, you feel more relaxed, you feel more at ease. The consequence of that is that you feel more, you have a deeper understanding of the teachings as a consequence. So these two things are two things that often work together. Yeah, ideally, I'm talking about ideal conditions now. Of course, things tend not to be ideal, but when they work, they become very powerful in this way. Mutually supporting things, meditation and the contemplation of the sutta, they mutually support each other. Yeah? It becomes a very beautiful thing when that happens. So this is the idea of this retreat. One of the things that come out of studying the suttas, yes, there is a lot of information there about how to apply ourselves in meditation practice. And I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to have a look at the Anapanasati Sutta, the Sutta on Mindfulness of Breathing. And this is probably the Buddha. Somebody wants to come in? Ghost? No. Okay. This is probably, in many ways, perhaps the most important of all the teachings of the Buddha on meditation practice. So we're going to dissect that sutta in many ways and try to kind of get deeper grasp of what mindfulness of breathing really is all about. So there's going to be a lot of focus on meditation as well through this sutta. But one of the things that I think is very important to understand about meditation practice and about spiritual practice in general is that it's not about one factor. Yeah? It's not about just doing meditation, it's not about just doing one particular thing, just mindfulness. Yeah? The word mindfulness is very kind of, you hear it everywhere these days. But it's not just about mindfulness. If you really want to have success in the spiritual practice, what you have to do is to practice a full set of what is called the Noble Eightfold Path in Buddhism. When you practice all the factors of the Noble Eightfold Path, that is when the spiritual practice becomes powerful. So one of the things I want to do, instead of just focusing on meditation, I'm going to focus on all the factors of the Noble Eightfold Path, how to integrate them, how to bring them together, so that when you leave this retreat, you don't feel completely lost, but you have something that you can work with in your daily life, when you go back home, whatever you do in life, you have something that you can take back with you to enhance your practice. So when you come back next year, Yeah, are you going to come back next year? It's too good to ask your master at the end of the retreat. So if you come back next year, you will have practiced in the meantime. Yeah, and then if you do the practice in the meantime in the right way, yeah, you come back next year, your meditation will be deeper next time around. And this is actually the measure, how we know that our meditation, our practice is working. It's measured by the qualities of mind that we develop. So if you develop, if your meditation goes better, your mindfulness is improving, your samadhi is improving, you feel kinder inside yourself, you feel more generous, you feel more peaceful in daily life, you have more compassion for people. Yeah, you feel less angry, less desire, less confused. If this is what's happening inside of you when you come on meditation, then you know you're heading in the right direction and you're having success in your spiritual life. But that is how you measure these things. So every year it should be a little bit better. Yeah? And I was going to say something, but I'm going to say it. So finally, the mind comes up with this thing, and you think, no, that's not, I shouldn't say that. Even when I feel a little bit tired, I think with a little bit mindfulness, which is good, otherwise I'd be in trouble. That is the idea behind this, to give you an integrated picture of Buddhism and also meditation instruction at the same time. So let us talk a little bit about meditation practice. Now, to start off, one of the very important teachings of the Buddha is called the teaching of the middle way, the Majjhima Patipadana. And I like to use Pali words sometimes, and I'm always going to try to translate into English as well, because some of these Pali words are very, after a while you get so used to them, that it becomes almost a language in its own right. So if I use Pali words without explaining and saying what they are, please let me know so I kind of, I don't kind of forget myself. So the Majjhima Patipadana, the middle way, is the very first teaching of the Buddha. The very first sutta that the Buddha gave is known as the Dhamma Chakka Pavattana Sutta, the discourse on setting in motion the wheel of the Dhamma. It's a very beautiful sutta I haven't included in this retreat because it can only do so many suttas. I wish I could do more, but it's only 8 days, 7 days, something like that. Unfortunately, you can only do so much, otherwise it gets too much. But it's a very beautiful sutta, and this is the very first sutta that the Buddha gives after his awakening. And you can imagine, if you after your awakening, your very first teaching that you give to the people around you is going to lay down the foundations of what Buddhism is all about. The Buddha has just discovered something very profound, seen the nature of reality. Now he's going to set out what this nature of reality is, to give people a feeling of what this is all about. And the very first thing that he says in the very first sutta is the middle way. So obviously this is very important, otherwise it wouldn't be the very first thing in the very first sutta. And what is this middle way? And what that middle way is, it is defined in a few slightly different ways. But the main thing about the middle way is the idea that we should, on the one hand, not indulge in sensual pleasures, and on the other hand, not torment or torture the body. So this is what the middle way is. Why is that so important? And one of the main reasons why this is so important is because people have a tendency to torture themselves. And this is so true. If you look around the world, you look at kind of all the spiritual practices around the world, regardless of the religion it is, regardless of, Hinduism are famous for, self-tormenting the body. In Christianity you find this, apparently you find it also in Islam, it's everywhere. The idea of spiritual practice having to do with tormenting the body. And I think it has something to do that is very deep with human psychology. The idea that the body really is about the pleasures of the world. So to neutralize these pleasures, the seeking of pleasures, we torture ourselves instead. So usually we seek pleasure. So by torturing yourself, kind of counteracts the pleasures, and then we kind of find the middle way by torturing the body a little bit. I think it's something like that, which kind of is the idea there. And then of course then you give up the pleasures because you don't see the pain of the body or whatever it is. So be very careful with this because I think it's a very powerful force in human beings that we tend to think that no pain, no gain, lots of pain, lots of gain, or something like that. Is that an alternative saying? No pain again, lots of pain, lots of pain. No, I haven't heard that one before, but maybe it's not an alternative way of thinking about it. And so be very careful about this. And what is so frightening about this is that this propensity that we have towards self-torture is so powerful, it is so strong, that even in Buddhist circles, when we are told in the very first discourse by the Buddha, don't do this, still, Buddhists everywhere around the world do exactly that. If you go on some of these retreats that are organized, you know, wherever it is, some of these retreats that tell you, well, if you have good painful feeling, just sit there, yeah? Don't move, observe, yeah? Don't kind of get too attached to it, just observe the painful feelings. This is kind of standard procedures in meditation retreats. But the Buddha says in the very first discourse, don't torture yourself. And yet I know so many people, they go through agony on meditation retreats, precisely because of the instructions. They've forgotten about the very first teaching of the Buddha. And so please, don't do the same thing here. Don't allow yourself to be kind of, to forget this very first teaching. So when you do that, you will find that you will find far more joy and happiness in your meditation than if you try to torture yourself too much. So please don't forget this very basic teaching. What does that mean in practice? And what it means in practice is that, first of all, sit in a way that is comfortable for yourself. Yeah. And remember, it's not a competition here, not about who can sit the longest cross-legged or anything like that. If you want to sit in a chair, please use the chairs here. Yeah? The chairs are here for a purpose, so please use them so you can be comfortable. Yeah? If you want, and don't think that you know you cannot have good meditation on chairs. I know people who use chairs who have very good meditation on chairs. So chairs is just as useful as any other posture that you can have. Another thing that you can do, if you like, is to just, you know, lean against the wall sometimes. Yeah, you can sit cross-legged if you want, but you can lean back against the wall. A little bit difficult here because it's kind of not that much space. You can sit over here, next to me if you like it. If you dare to sit next to me. You can lean against the wall over here, or over there as well. You can do it if you like it. So find a posture that works for you. Yeah, and what often is the case, even if you are used to sitting cross-legged on the floor, there comes a point when your legs and your back won't take it anymore. Change your posture. Take a seat, take a chair instead for a while. Lean against the wall instead for a while. Move back and forth a little bit, yeah? And in this way, you avoid this getting too much pain in whatever part of the body that is problematic for you. Don't be afraid of doing that. Don't think that there is some obligatory position that you have to hold full lotus for the next 7 days. If you do that, you're going to be in serious agony at the end of the 7 days. So this is the first lesson. Move around a little bit. And if you do feel a lot of pain during the meditation, don't be shy about moving during the meditation itself. Just do it quietly and do it kind of peacefully. Shift your legs a little bit. Even if you have to get up, but yeah, and move, it is okay if you have a lot of pain there. And we will have compassion for you if you do that. When we hear you getting up in the middle of it, we know that you have a problem, so we will straight away give us everyone else a chance to have compassion for you. So don't be afraid of these things. And then I think you are practicing in the right way. If you do that, what is very interesting about this, because this is the reason why this is called the middle way. Don't torture yourself, you don't indulge in things. It's not really a middle way. It's actually the way of the mind rather than the way of the body. If you indulge in sensual pleasures, you will have an attachment to your senses. You will have an attachment, you will seek seeking happiness in the world around you. And if you are seeking happiness in the five senses, if you are seeking happiness through the body, it is very hard to let go of it because you have an attachment to those things. Wherever you find your happiness in the world, that is where you will have an attachment. And what that means is that your meditation will only go so far, and then it will stop. Why? Because you can't let go any further, because you know that now you're letting go of too much happiness, you're not willing to do that. Yeah? So you act, the more we seek for happiness outside, the more attached we are to that, the less ability you will have to actually go inside and let go of those things. And the interesting thing is that exactly the same problem happens if you have, if you torture yourself. Why is that? Because if you torture yourself, you again, you have a problem in the body, yeah? You have a problem in the five senses, and because of that, the mind again will tend to go out to the body, go out to the five senses, because there is a problem to be resolved. Yeah? If you have a lot of pain in the body, watch what your mind does, and what your mind does, it goes to that pain again and again and again, because you really want to get rid of it. There is a problem there, the problem needs to be resolved. Yeah? So the body becomes important. If you take away both the pain and the pleasure that comes to the five senses and the body becomes irrelevant. The five senses become irrelevant. Yeah, if there's nothing in the body to be gained or nothing to be resolved, the whole thing is kind of doesn't matter anymore. And if it doesn't matter anymore, that is when you can let go of it. That's where it becomes possible to let go of the body. Meditation is the art of developing the mind. So we really want to get the body out of the way. The only way you're going to do that is precisely by finding this middle way. It's not really a middle way, it's a way of getting rid of the body and being able to focus on the mind instead. Yeah, you can see what is going on here, hopefully. And this is kind of the purpose of this middle way. This is why torturing yourself is not going to work. Yeah, you're going to have a little bit of pain now and again. Okay, that's not a big deal. But if it is a persistent problem and you get slightly obsessed with it, the mind going back to it again and again, that is the time to do something about it. So please remember this. You may think that this is very basic instructions, but actually this instruction is one of those that everybody tends to forget all the time. So please don't forget that. Yeah? And again, if you're going to err on the side of a little bit of indulgence, don't err on the side of self-torturing. Yeah? And you do this, when the body kind of becomes irrelevant, and hopefully you will find that this actually happens to you a little bit on this retreat, yeah? The body sort of fades a little bit into the background, the body doesn't matter to you anymore, then what comes into the focus is the mind. So then the development of the mind happens really from that point. But what you will find is that if you are able to make the body really comfortable, first of all, not torturing the body, the second stage of working with the body is not just not torturing it, but actually finding the ease of the body. Where the body is really nice and comfortable, you feel really at ease, you feel a sense of, you know, being so delighted by being inside of your own body because it actually is so easy and so nice. To take a lot of time, especially at the beginning of a retreat like this, I don't know if you come from a job which is really stressful or whatever, maybe you come from the city, from London. I just came from London yesterday and I thought, geez, this is, you know, so busy, just stressful just by kind of looking at people, you get stressed, yeah, let alone actually doing the stuff that they're doing. If you come from that kind of environment, it takes a while before you kind of calm down and you rest. And one of the ways of knowing whether you have a bit of stress or not, and sometimes you may not even be aware of it yourself, is to look at your body. Is your body at ease? Are you feeling really relaxed? Yeah? Are you just kind of really happy with your body? So start off by feeling your body. Every meditation, making sure you are really at ease. Because little tensions have a kind of tendency to sneak themselves in there. So make sure you ease up those tensions every time. And when the tensions in the body are eased up, your mind tends to follow along. Because the reason why the tensions are there in the first place is because the mind is controlling the body to some extent. It comes from the mind, yeah? So by focusing on the body, it is an indirect way of dealing with the mind itself. So by focusing on the body, you can do body sweeping if you like it, yeah? Looking throughout your body, especially those places where you have a bit of tension or discomfort, and then easing it up by having a sense of compassion and kindness for yourself. Yeah, looking at those parts of the body with a sense of metta and karuna, yeah, we are etc. Yeah, anukampa is also the idea of having compassion. So really, we should have that because we are here to support the anukampa project. The best way to support that is to actually do it. Yeah, to have anukampa and compassion. You develop these things, and you have a sense of care for yourself. You look after yourself. You look after your own body. Then you actually, things tend to calm down and they become nice and the mind follows along as a consequence. And then what you find is that if you do this in the right way, mindfulness starts to arise. Mindfulness arises almost by itself if you get these things right. Yeah, it almost comes out of nothing. Yeah? Because you are relaxing, because you are at ease, because you are enjoying what is happening here, yeah? There's nothing much you have to do except watch mindfulness coming into being. Yeah? You know, as the problems disappear, the defilements leave the mind, the mindfulness starts to arise. And that is where meditation really starts. When mindfulness arises, that is when meditation actually begins. So what are some of the helping factors that help us in giving rise to mindfulness? One of the very interesting things, if you have listened, for example, to my teacher, Ajahn Brahmali, yeah, everybody knows about Ajahn Brahmali, presumably, yeah? You almost have to kind of live underground in a cave without internet connection not to know about Ajahn Brahmali, because he's everywhere these days. If you know how he teaches meditation, sometimes it can be very frustrating. You say to Ajahn Brahmali, what should I do? My mind isn't getting still, what should I do? Do nothing. No, but what am I supposed to do? For goodness sake, do nothing. But no, I don't get it. I'm over trying this, it doesn't work. Do nothing. Yeah, and you feel kind of frustrated because this is how he teaches meditation practice. And it is so, and I've always thought, I remember when I was, starting out in my monastic life, I thought he was exaggerating. What do you mean doing nothing? He said, possibly you've got to do a few little things. The Buddha talks about why effort, he talks about being virtuous and kind and all these kind of things. You've got to do something. Yeah, you've got to guide the mind in the right direction. You've got to kind of point it this way and that way. You've got to watch the breath, for goodness sake. Yeah. And then I started reading the suttas. Actually, I started that from the very beginning. It took me a while, though, to really comprehend the message in the suttas. And one of these very beautiful suttas, and it's a sutta I haven't actually chosen for this retreat, but I will talk about it anyway, indirectly. And this is the suttas that I call the dependent liberation. Yeah, it's the opposite, if you like, of dependent origination. Dependent origination shows us how suffering arises in the world, and why we actually suffer. Dependent liberation is about the process that releases us from suffering. And in a very large sense, it is about what happens in our meditation practice. What does meditation feel like? And in this sequence of dependent liberation, what the Buddha says in there, and this was so powerful when I read this. He shows us stage by stage how we go from one degree of happiness to a higher degree of happiness, to an even higher degree of happiness, to an even higher one, to samadhi, to seeing things according to reality. But the most powerful thing that he says about this, he says that as you go through these steps of various degrees of happiness, ending up with samadhi, ending up with deep insight into the nature of reality, he says each one of these steps cannot be done by an act of will. Na chetanaya karaniya, not to be done by an act of will. So if it is not to be done by an act of will, what is it? And the Buddha says it is done because this is in accordance with the reality that if you develop the factor which is prior to the next one will follow as a consequence. In other words, it's a natural emergence of qualities of mind that happen if the will is taken out of the equation. You withdraw the will is actually a problem, and as you withdraw the will and you get things right, this whole thing happens and it merges by itself. This is what the Buddha is saying. And this is what I mean by, the idea of having teachings by a teacher that you trust to some extent, and then reading the suttas and seeing the match-up between the suttas and how the Buddha teaches and how your teachers teaches, and you think, boy, why am I not listening to Ajahn Brahm? Why am I kind of thinking that he is taking things too far? Here it is, right there. Don't do anything. Allow these things to arise, and as a consequence, all of these things start to happen as a consequence. It's so beautiful, and the reason why it is so beautiful is because it is so easy in a way. There's nothing you have to do. Yeah, you just have to sit back, you have to be patient. That's pretty hard already, of course, but it's hard in a different way, yeah? You have to be patient, you have to allow things to arise, and then all of these magical things, because really they aren't magical. This is kind of the thing about meditation practice, it's almost like magic. You sit back and you wait, and bliss just happens. Who doesn't want that? Isn't that kind of cool? It's just, it's almost mind-blowing. All you have to do is sit back, lean against the wall. If you get it right, if you get out of the way, you do nothing, bliss just happens. This is meditation for you. This is how the Buddha teaches meditation. It's just so, when you think about it, it's so beautiful because it's so incredibly simple, and it's such a completely different way how we normally think about the world. We think about the world, we have to go out there, we have to create happiness in our own lives. So, notice, says the Buddha, if you want real happiness, the more you create, the more suffering you create. It is by non-creation that happiness starts to arise. By withdrawing the creator inside, the doer, the thing that tries to control the world, that is where happiness actually happens. It's a radical different way of understanding how we actually create happiness in life. So this is the idea behind this. This is why the idea, this whole thing about this path being automatic, being so simple. Yeah, nothing you have to do, it happens by itself. This is what I'm talking about here, when you just sit back and you just enjoy yourself and you have to be patient. But of course, it is actually quite hard to do this for most people. And because of that, one of the things that we often have to do is we have to nudge the mind a little bit, kind of nudge it very gently in the right direction. And if we do that, things then start to happen as a consequence. But one of the very interesting things about this sutta, which talks about this natural emergence of liberation, you know, without using the will, what is interesting about that is, of course, the very first factor, because this is a sequence of conditioned factors. And if you have a sequence of conditioned factors, one leading to the next one, the very first one is going to be the most important one. Yeah, because the first one, if you get that one right, everything else is going to happen as a consequence. So what is the first factor? The first factor is sila. Sila is morality, it is virtue, it is our character, it is our habits. Yeah, this is what sila is about. The idea of sila is very profound in Buddhism. It encompasses so many aspects. We're going to talk a lot more about sila as we go through this retreat. But that is where the development is. That is where it really is at. And if meditation doesn't happen automatically, as I'm talking about now, it is because the sila hasn't been developed enough at the very beginning. That shows you the power of sila in Buddhism and why it is so important, how it integrates with the idea of meditation. That is where you have to start out. So one of the things then on a retreat like this is to kind of, if you wish, tap into the sila that you have already developed in your life as a Buddhist or as a, you know, I don't know if all of you here consider yourself as Buddhist, doesn't matter what you consider yourself as, a spiritual practitioner, meditator, whatever it is to tap into that sila that you have already lived. Yeah, for a long time already. How do we do that? The Buddha explained this in many different ways, but one of the things I want to just point out on this retreat is that it's very useful to keep an even mind during this retreat, not to allow yourself to be too touched by the people around you in terms of being irritated and these things. We live quite closely together, and when you live closely together with others, it's easy sometimes to get a bit irritated, somebody slammed the door a bit too loud or whatever. So one of the important things on a retreat like this is to have a sense of metta and karuna and kindness to all the people who are here. Yeah, and to be able to do that, I would just like to remind you that the group of people that you are with on this retreat, it is incredibly hard to find people like this. People who come together, 50 people, if you haven't shown up yet, but eventually will be 50 people hopefully. 50 people who voluntarily give up a week of their life just to sit with their eyes closed on a cushion in a hall like this, doing absolutely nothing, and just developing your minds, practicing kindness. Isn't that wonderful? Aren't we fortunate to have companions like this in the world? So remind yourself that these are the companions you have here. These are people, everyone here is worthy of so much respect because you're already living such a wonderful life. Yeah, so when somebody does a little thing which is kind of bad or you don't understand because they have a different perception of reality, remember the big picture. These people around here are really good people. At the very least, they are trying really hard to be good people. Yeah, and that trying is actually enough to deserve enormous respect. So even if you don't feel 100% pure yet, who does anyway, nobody, few people feel 100% pure, even if that is the case, the very fact that you are here, the very fact that you are intending climbing in that direction, wow, it is already worthy of tremendous respect. So remember that. And when you remember that, you won't be upset by the people around you. You'll have a sense of metta, you're able to see the wonderful qualities, and yeah, taking the eight precepts, developing yourself, helping the people around you, helping the whole world to become a better place. What a wonderful thing that is. This is one of the beautiful ways of making sure that we have a sense of harmony on this retreat, that we don't allow ourselves to be disturbed by the little things of daily life that otherwise can be disturbing sometimes. So this is one way of having what I would call right attitude on this retreat. This is one way of, if you like, of using the idea of sila, of morality, of character development, using it in such a way that it becomes supportive for the retreat environment and also for your own practice of meditation. There are other ways of doing this, and the Buddha specifically talks in the suttas about things like sila nusati, which means recollection of your virtue, yeah, or morality. He talks about chaga nusati, which means recollection of your generosity. So sometimes, if you want to try it out, you can try sometimes just to sit back and feel if there is some memory inside of you about something you have done in the past that made a very powerful impact on your mind. There may have been something you did in the past, the time when you were very kind to somebody, you did an act of generosity spontaneously, yeah, and you felt very joyful afterwards. Now is the time you can tap into that joy. Yeah, you can allow your mind to go back in time, and you can kind of feel that feeling all over again that it had at the time in the past. If it was very powerful at that time, it would have made a powerful impact on your mind, it's easy to bring up the memory again. See if that works. And when you, but don't force it, just allow your mind to go there almost by itself. And if you can tap into some of those experiences, bring that joy into the present moment, that joy will then enable you to practice your meditation far better. When you get joy in the mind that is connected with the wholesome, the defilements go down automatically. Yeah, you don't really desire things anymore, you don't have any ill will anymore, the joy is the opposite of these other defilements. So actually, your mind is purified right then and then. That is why meditation becomes possible in that kind of situation. So this is about having the right attitude, yeah, the attitude, and this can be developed in many ways, just enjoying the place here, peaceful, yeah, notice that during meditation, notice the peace around you, because if you notice the peace around you, you will also bring it inside of you. This is another way of having right attitude. Feel the atmosphere. So many people sitting quietly together, yeah, in a beautiful place. I have never been to the Peak District before, but just kind of driving in there. It's a very beautiful drive in from when the Bhuchanda's parents had us for lunch today. We drove all the way through here. Very, very beautiful when we came through. Just enjoying the environment. Also the idea of being away, being a bit outside of your ordinary situation, your house or whatever. Yeah, coming to a place which is a little away from those things. Feeling the decrease in burdens in your life. Here you have nothing to do, yeah, no house, no family, none of that business. Just feel that sense of ease when there is no burdens in your life. All of these things are what I mean by right attitude. All these positive perceptions that will help you to remind you of those things as we do the guided meditations during this retreat. One last thing that I will mention, because as always, time goes very fast. I don't know how it. I don't think I have said very much, but still, somehow time has disappeared. This is the problem with samsara. You talk and talk and talk, and then you die. Yeah, and you realize you talk too much. You should have shut up a long time ago. But so one last thing. And this is I always found one of the very other interesting things about what is the support for meditation practice. Is what is called in the suttas Ujjukaditi. And Ujjukaditi, Ujju means straight in Pali. It is actually directly related to the word right or straight in English. Yeah, the word straight is actually the same word. Ujju may not sound like the straight same word, but actually it is. In root it comes from the same thing. Yeah. Straight view is Ujjukaditi. Yeah, and one of the ideas of straight view is the idea of knowing what to prioritize in your life. What really matters, what actually really is important in your life. And when you come on a meditation retreat, in fact, whenever you do any kind of meditation, even at home or wherever you do it, is to get this feeling of priorities right. Knowing what is really important in your life, what actually matters. And one of the mistakes that people often do, they think that I'm going to learn to meditate so it can support the rest of my life. Yeah, I'm going to do this so I can be more efficient at my work, I can be more kind to the people around me, kind of be more kind to my children and wife or husband or whatever it is, so I can function better. Meditation is there. It's a secondary thing used to support all the other aspects in my life. But if you do that, if you think like that, and it's meditation is secondary, and everything else in your life is primary, and you use meditation to support everything else, guess what happens? What happens is, when you close your eyes, you start thinking about all those other things in your life, because they are primary. What is primary, what is really important to you, is where your mind is going to go. These are the things you're going to think about. Yeah, your mind will go back to your family life, it will go into your job, it will go into all those important unresolved problems. Yeah, that is what's going to happen. So what you have to do, you have to use a trick of perception to remind you that what really matters in your life, at the end of the day, what actually really is important, is not all these other things. Where you really find the meaning of life is not in work, in family life and all that. These things are not unimportant. I'm not suggesting they are irrelevant. They are certainly important, but they are secondary to the development of the spiritual life. It is when you develop meditation deeply, when you change your inner constitution towards more kindness, compassion, and all of these things, that is what the meaning of life really is about. Of course, it does affect your work life, it does affect your family life, it will be a force for good in the world in everything you do, but you don't make those other things primary. You make the development of the spiritual path the primary thing, because you know ultimately this is where you're going to find real meaning. And what is so astonishing about the practice of meditation, one of the things I will point out later on as well, that the deeper you go into meditation practice, you start to feel that you are experiencing the very meaning of life itself. This is what is so amazing about this path. Yeah, everyone in the world is searching for some kind of goal, some kind of purpose, some kind of meaning, going somewhere which actually matters. Nobody ever gets there. And then you turn inward, you start practicing a spiritual path, and for the first time in your life, you start to feel that all those things you were seeking for all that time in the world outside, you find them directly here inside of yourself instead. This is extraordinarily powerful, and it means that this is where you find real meaning, this is where you find real purpose, this is what life is really about. And when you get that, when you come to your meditation, because your spiritual life is primary, your worldly life is secondary, you don't think about your worldly life anymore. It becomes irrelevant. Your worldly life is a support for your spiritual life. How you treat your family members, how you perform at work, how you treat your co-workers. Of course you do it well, of course you do it with love and care, all these kind of things. But precisely because you do it well, it becomes also a factor that helps you in developing your spiritual life. In this way, because you are prioritizing your meditation practice, prioritizing the spiritual life, when you sit down, you don't think about your worldly life anymore. Instead, your mind tends to become peaceful and quiet and all these other things, because this is your priority. That's the theory, yeah? The reality is a bit more complicated, unfortunately, but that is the theory. So but it's just a very useful perception. Try sometimes to use that perception. As you do that, as you develop these kind of perceptions, after a while, they become a force, they become a skillful means that you can actually use in your own meditation practice, and you can actually develop over time also in your ordinary life as well. Okay, so that is all I want to say for tonight. So maybe let's just start off by doing a little bit, and that's what you said probably, doing a little bit of meditation together. Just kind of gently.